Welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. Dorothy Butler Gilliam's 50-year career as a journalist put her in the forefront of the fight for social justice. Her latest book, Trailblazer, A Pioneering Journalist's Fight to Make the Media Look More Like America, offers a comprehensive view of racial relations and the media in the United States. Dorothy, welcome to UDC Forum.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
This book has just trailblazing, even as it is a trailblazer. Tell us about what inspired you to write it for such a time as this.
Well, actually, I didn't necessarily write it for such a time as this. This is a very special time we're going through right now. But, and I think it was almost providential that it came out at this time. I wrote the book because I think it's so important for African Americans to tell their own stories. Mm-hmm. We often talk about history, and we want to expand that to include herstory as well.
Yes.
And so that is my motivation for writing it. I also wanted to write it a book that also included all of the other people with whom I worked to help make the media look more like America. It was not a one-person task, as I share in the book. The starting of the Maynard Institute for Journalism Education, where we trained over the years over 1,000 journalists as reporters and editors and managers. That was very much a joint effort. I was privileged to serve as the chair of the board for nearly 10 years. But there has been so much push in this country by African Americans to make this a better country. And I was just really thrilled to be a part of it.
What's interesting, the book itself is amazing. Thank you for writing
Thank
it.
Thank you.
What I found unique and interesting was your perspective coming from the South, not the D.C.'s, not in the South, but coming to Washington and not finding it perhaps as liberal or as inclusive as you thought it might have been?
Yes, I grew up in the segregated South, came of age in Louisville, Kentucky, and I had not traveled broadly or widely, so when I was hired by the Washington Post as its first black female reporter in 1961, I was appalled, really, at what a segregated city Washington, D.C., the nation's capital, was. So it really was a hindrance to me in doing my work. It was impossible almost to get taxi cabs to pick me up, and I would be standing out on the corner at 15th and L, where the Post was located at that time, you know, waving my hands and saying, stop, I want a cab, and, you know, they would, you know, slow down and look at my brown face, and the white drivers would hit the accelerator. And so those were awful times. The city was very segregated. It was also before the civil rights movement had succeeded in changing the laws. Mm. We know that Martin Luther King had been just doing a wonderful job. He's the architect of the 21st century. In my mind, he's so amazing. But it would be several years before we got the Public Accommodations Act, and before we got the Voting Rights Act. So it was really challenging doing the job in a segregated nation's capital.
One of the things that's unique about Washington, along with being the first freed, when the Compensated Emancipation Act freed enslaved people here, was sort of a prestige about being an African American in Washington, D.C., even despite or maybe because of some segregation, that there were these entities, the churches, the sororities, the groups. How did you find the reception from the African American community in Washington, D.C.?
I found it very positive when I first came to Washington. I looked first to a journalist because that's what I am, and that's what those are the people I knew. For example, I worked for about 4.5 years in the black press before I was hired by the Washington Post. So when I looked around, I went to Jet Magazine and talked to Simeon Booker. Mm. When I needed help in finding a place to live, I went to Jet Magazine and talked to Fanny Granton, who was who became one of the associate editors. So I found that a very welcoming community. Now, I did not get too involved in sororities and fraternities and things like that. I had joined a sorority when I attended a historically black college, but did not stay, I'm just not much of a joiner. But in general, I found people, you know, very pleasant and helpful. But I have to say I did restrict my communication with people I knew best.
In the book, you talk about going to do an interview with a white woman who was elderly and was having a reception because, I think it was because of her age or an important event. And the African-American doorman, thinking that you were a maid and sending you to the back of the building.
That was again part of the whole rigid segregation that existed in the nation's capital. So yes, it was. I was going to cover a 100th birthday party of a white woman, and when I walked up to the door, and you know, I was dressed in my, you know, nice heels and a nice dress. I thought I looked professional, and I walked up, and the doorman said, "Well, the maid's entrance is around the back." And I was very icy. Not that I think there's anything wrong with being a maid. I mean, my mother was forced to be a maid. But, you know, for him to just presume that, you know, I said, I'm a reporter for the Washington Post. And I pulled out my identification, and he took it in. And the guy at the desk, they must have talked for a while. And then they called upstairs, and they knew there was an event being held. So I was finally let in the front door and on the elevator to go in and cover the event. But those kind of events were difficult. I mean, one of the other things about the taxi cabs was that if I couldn't get a cab, I would have trouble sometimes making my deadline. So luckily, I had taken shorthand for 2 years in college. So I was able, while I'm standing on the corner trying to hail a cab, to also start writing the story in shorthand so that when I got back to the office, I would at least have a head start on the story, because it was like, at that point, you know, carrying two invisible weights that all the white men at the Post and the white women didn't have to carry. Now, the women, most of the women worked in the women's section, so this was before, you know, the integration, really, of the news media, almost.
I love that story, not because of the indignity or injustice, but the fact that you were prepared, and so you had this other skill, and then you utilized that, which speaks to how women of color have sort of persevered and been able to overcome these obstacles, the preparation, the ability to be creative and to think out of necessity, how I can get this done. There were two African-American reporters, male reporters, at the Post at the time. How were they supportive of you?
The main one who was supportive was a guy named Luther Jackson, and his father was actually a college president. Luther was he reported on urban affairs and I think housing, as memory serves. Mm-hmm. And the other was Wallace Terry. Mm-hmm. Terry went on to write a marvelous book called Bloods,
yes,
about the blacks in Vietnam. And he was certainly very kind, except he didn't, I don't recall him really being in the office a lot. He managed to be on the road a lot. So the one I remember most was Luther Jackson. And he was the one I could confide in and you know, share. We would share our humiliations, the indignities that we had to face in order to do the job. And he was somebody I knew I could go to lunch with. One of the things that at that point, the restaurants were mostly segregated. And so there was one place where we knew we could go and be comfortable, and that was a cafeteria called Shoals Cafeteria.
Yes.
But in terms of restaurants, I did find out that, you know, if you entered with a white person, you know, you were more likely to get in. It was awful. It was a segregation in America. It was such a harsh, harsh time. And as you said, yes, black people were so creative and so unique that, yes, we made the most out of what we had, including, as you said, the organizations, the clubs, the churches. And, you know, having grown up in Louisville, my dad was a minister. Mm-hmm. And the church was a very important part of who I am today and who I was even more than 50 years ago when I came to the Post, because, you know, that black religious experience and that black culture, you know, it puts something in you that helps you to stand when the humiliation wants you to run and slap somebody and you can't do that, you know?
Right.
And so I think all of this is just such a positive check on the black, the importance of black people and the importance of our culture, our religious experience, our history. Mm. And it's something I hope that we always hold on to and really hold dear, because it's extraordinary. It's extraordinarily unique as well.
Your career at the Post evolved from doing the 100 birthday parties to your own column, very much a respected expert in your field. What is it that you wanted to do at the Post, perhaps that you didn't write about, or what was the story that is your prize story that you wrote about? Mm.
Well, I think one of the prize stories was early in my career in 1962 when I went to cover the integration of the University of Mississippi. The Post had several people there. I definitely was not sent to cover the campus, because that I would have been dead meat trying to cover the campus. There was total anarchy, because this one black man named James Meredith had the audacity to step forward into the middle of this state that was a state of lynching, a state of killing. It was really a horrible state. And once again, black people made the most, did the best they could with what they had. But the fact that I was sent to cover the reaction of the black community was, to me, very exciting. And I think in covering it, I uncovered some stereotypes, because blacks were being stereotyped in the early 60s and all of that as, you know, fearful, stereotyped as, you know, inferior, all of these, you know, these lies, really. And so to go to the black community there and have them tell me about their pride in what James Meredith had done, that was a thrill. And to report that in the Post, yes, they were unsettled. There was some fear. But unlike some of the other writers who wrote about that period, and who talked about how the blacks were so scared they ran up in the hills to avoid what was happening in Oxford, Mississippi at the university, I found people who were thrilled. Some said, yeah, we're gonna leave after this. But they were, felt like they were armed for battle. And the other part of that very memorable trip was going to interview Medgar Evers, and hearing his determination that despite the anarchy on the campus, they would be pushing to integrate more colleges. And he was just ticking them off to me, you know, the Mississippi State, I think it was called Women's College, but you know, these, that we're gonna push, we're gonna fight. And he did. And unfortunately, because of the violence of white supremacy, he was assassinated, you know, in his own driveway about 6 or 7 months after I interviewed him. So often in those cases, the person who shot a black person was never ever prosecuted or anything. So I've always admired the fact that Merle Evers, his wife, pushed and pushed and made certain that the perpetrator of that crime stood trial, and was, and that was to me another example of that bravery of black people.
One of the important pieces for me of having you there as a historian was when you just said you documented the reaction of African Americans to that, which was in contrast to what the narrative would have been if the white reporters had just written what they wrote, and there was no platform or space for the voices of individuals in the community of color to talk about what they actually felt and the pride, and it was a combination of things. And I think that's what's so key when you're talking about making history inclusive and including those voices that don't get told, that don't get heard and don't have space. Mm-hmm. And you provided that. That was so critical as you went about documenting this. Were you aware at the time of the watershed moment that you were creating?
Not at that moment in the early 60s. I became much more aware of it when I kind of went back to the Post in the early 70s. One of the reasons, because gender was an issue, it was that I left the Post after about 5 years because I'd gotten married and started having children, and they didn't have any kind of flex time for women, so I just quit. And then I was rehired by the Post in 1972. And when I got back in 1972, and I was an editor, hired as an editor in the style section, it was very clear that it was important for me to bring black culture into the Washington Post style section. And I think because in the early days when I was there, I would hear things that you know, one old white editor used to say, well, we don't cover black murders because they're cheap murders, you know. And at that point, I couldn't do anything to make it different. But when I went back as an editor, this was an opportunity to hire people. You know, one of the great things I was able to do, I stole a reporter from the Washington Star named Jacqueline Trescott.
Oh,
and
yes.
And she was a marvelous reporter on cultural events and you know, had such respect for the community and very Afrocentric. So she was a person I hired to help bring black culture to a larger audience, because so much of our culture had been distorted. You know, we'd gone through the Jim Crow era and, you know, all these terrible eras. So to be able to bring that, I knew that was a watershed moment. And there were a lot of other, you know, reporters too that I was able to bring forward. There were also reporters who were already there that I was able to work with even more. One reporter was Holly West, who was a marvelous writer about jazz and all kinds of music, but also he'd do deep stories about black intellectuals. And sometimes they would run for, you know, 2 or 3 days. They were so strong and so beautifully done. So we were educating both the black community and the white community about black people and black culture in a way that had not really been done before.
Now, when you came back in the 70s, that was Shirley Chisholm's time, and her comment was she had more opposition, and I'm badly paraphrasing, had more opposition because of her gender than because of her race. And you had mentioned gender in your comment. How difficult or how easy, what was the difference? Even though you're now back as an editor, it's still that sort of perfect storm moment when we're talking civil rights, we're talking women's rights, Native Americans' rights, mm-hmm. LGBT rights. Mm-hmm. So what was it like with that environment as you're trying to bring more African Americans on, exposing the culture of African Americans mm-hmm. in the city?
Well, you're right, it was it really was a perfect storm, because one of the things that women were doing, and I joined in, we were suing for equal pay. The New York Times had a group of women who sued. We were suing for more women editors. Blacks were suing for, I talk in my book about the Metro 7, seven young black journalists who sued the Post. Well, they didn't, they were on the brink of it. But again, saying, you know, we want to be able to cover some of these big stories, you know, and they pushed. So in terms of the female part of that, we were part of the upward thrust. And I just don't recall a lot of negative, response from other black male reporters. I think the response to all of this was to the larger white male dominant group in the newspaper. That was, you know, we have to you have to change. You need more female editors. You need them on all the sections, and also you need more blacks. So we knew we had to fight to make a difference. And that's what we did. That's when we started the Maynard Institute for Journalism Education. One of the things that I recall is when we'd go and talk to white editors, and we'd say, we need to hire more blacks. And they said, we just can't find any qualified. And we knew that was a lie, but we knew we had to do something. We took some action. And that's when, you know, a group of black, white, male, female, we got together and started the Maynard Institute. And the leader of that was really a man named Robert C. Maynard. Mm-hmm. And he's the one who pulled me in to be a part of it. So I didn't find the gender differences, you know, very stark at all in terms of, you know, black people working together. But as I said, the only way we changed some of the larger issues were we filed suits.
I just wanted to ask you also, and I don't know if you were at the Post at this time when we had the rebellion or the riots here mm-hmm. in the district mm-hmm. after Dr. King's assassination, right. But what did you think of that coverage?
No, I was living in Washington, but I was not working for the Post. I left the Post in about 1965, 66.
Okay.
And I just did not get involved in the coverage at all.
One of the things that we know is important is for young people to have not only exposure to our history, but a respect for the ability to document, to chronicle, to be a part of the recording of history going forward. Now, you've worked with young people in a journalism institute.
Yes, the Institute for Journalism Education was one that we started that trained African Americans to be journalists. And but that was just one thing we did. One of the things I was happy to be able to do after my reporting and editing career, even after my column writing career, was to start a program at the Post called the Young Journalist Development Program, where Post reporters went out to high schools in Washington and we found potential talent. But we did it by helping them put out their own high school newspapers, or if they had television, we did whatever they had. We helped them do whatever media they had. And so that was a very important part of my life and my background and my work, because it was part of how you make the media look more like America. Mm. I always thought, because the Post program worked so well, that's journalists going out to help high school students, I thought maybe this can be a national program. So I was able to go to GW, George Washington University, and start a program there called Prime Movers Media. This was a program for which I had to raise the funds. GW offered, you know, some basic funds. But that program went on for about 10 years. And we brought a lot of young people in. Again, just having journalists go out into to the community, into high schools. And the journalists loved it. I still think of people like Sam Ford of Channel 7 and his photographer. They did great work with the students at Ballou High School. And we were fortunate also to actually go to another city and start a Prime Movers program. And that was Prime Movers Philadelphia. And that program is not as powerful as it once was, but it hasn't quite stopped. And part of that is that it was part of the school district program. We were able to help them actually write a curriculum, a media curriculum. And they use that not only here in Washington, one of the charter schools here, especially the Richard Wright Charter School is one. We were able to help them write their curriculum. So it was at least 15 or 20 years of my career was spent working with young people and trying to, again, bring them into that mainstream media.
This has been an amazing conversation, and I would like to see if we could have you back to talk about contemporary journalism and what you see happening today in terms of the discipline and the involvement of young people, especially African Americans and HBCUs, how we're moving forward with our journalism and our history and connecting that together. But thank you very much for being a part of UDC Forum.
Thank you so much for asking me.
If you are interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the many degree, certificate, and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, please visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.